Jonathan, do we have anything in the email today?
I don't know. Usually check. I'll check. No problem.
Okay.
Whoa, wow. Holy smokes. We got another one on SPE.
Oh.
Yeah, one about is protein precipitation good enough when dealing with biological samples?
Oh, that is a fantastic question. I'm excited to tackle this one.
Yeah, yeah. We know that biologics have things in there like salts, fats, proteins, even these things, phospholipids.
Yep. But we have to think about how those things are going to affect our sample, because they can cause things like matrix effects, cause ion suppression. They can cause chromatography to not be reproducible. They can have contaminants build up on our system and causes all kinds of problems. So this is definitely one I'm excited to look at.
All right, well, let's take a look at it.
Okay.
All right, Kim, I'm excited to test this myth. How are we gonna do it?
Sure, so this one can be pretty straightforward. I mean, what we wanna test is the ability to just use protein precipitation and see if we can get reproducible quantification and chromatography, right?
Okay, right.
So what we can do is do a traditional protein precipitation. We'll do a 1-to-3 protein crash with acetonitrile in our sample. We'll use plasma.
That's good.
And then we'll just keep making injections of this sample over and over and over again with a typical gradient that you would use in bioanalysis.
All
right. We'll go to a high percentage of acetonitrile to potentially wash off the column. And then we'll just monitor the phospholipids, since they're the major cause of matrix effects, cause issues with quantification. And then we can just see what that looks like after when we take a look at the actual trace.
So we can look at something like the area count, for example, and we'll just monitor that and see if that fluctuates.
Absolutely.
It's a good idea.
Yep, let's set it up.
All right, let's do it. So Kim, we talked about one of the major problems when doing these biological samples is phospholipids. So that's something that I think we definitely are gonna have to monitor.
Absolutely.
So for those that don't know what a phospholipid is, it's this long kind of molecule that has a polar head group up front and this long hydrophobic chains that tail off at the end. It's those hydrophobic chains that can kind of stick or bond to a most reverse phase column. In this experiment, we're gonna monitor the transition, that 184, and we'll take a look at the data over some replicate injections.
Awesome.
So here we've done some multiple injections, just one after the other, just kind of monitoring how these phospholipids kind of build up on the column. And you can see really early on, say up to maybe injection 5 or 6, the phospholipid count coming off the column isn't that much. But over time, boy, you really can see how they're really starting to coat the column, come off the column, and not come off at the same rate. So you get a lot of irregularity, irreproducibility, which causes a lot of problems for the chromatography.
Yep. You're exactly right, JT. And if we look at the chromatography to see how these phospholipids would actually impact the analytical results, we can see a really interesting story. If we look at the top chromatogram here, we can see that the first protein precipitation injection, and here we're just monitoring the phospholipids, you can see that they've just started to build up on the column, but they're really not causing us any kind of a problem.
Right.
But if we look at the bottom chromatogram, we can see that by the last injection, now those phospholipids have really built up, and they're starting to co-elute with our risperidone and our clopidogrel, and they could be causing things like matrix effects, causing higher column back pressure, but most importantly, causing us problems with being able to get reproducible quantification.
Yeah, so protein precipitation just isn't good enough to clean up these biological samples.
Unfortunately, it's not. It's easy, and you know, sometimes, you know, we scientists like to do the easiest thing, but you know, in this case, it's really not getting us where we need to go.
Okay. So Kim, how do you want to call this one? We kind of did our experiments. What do you think?
I know. Well, I think we have to call it busted, because protein precipitation really isn't enough to make sure that you have good reproducible quantification.
Yeah, I agree, but I don't feel real good about it. We are kind of leaving the customer hanging.
I know. I feel like we're not giving them the best advice. So maybe we can just go a little bit further and extend this experiment.
Yeah, this calls for bonus time.
I think bonus time.
Let's do it. All right, I got the perfect sample, Kim, for this experiment. Synthetic cannabinoids, there's 22 species in this sample mix, and the sample's whole blood.
Ooh.
So a real challenging, complex mixture and a really tough matrix.
Oh, definitely. So since we're going to do whole blood, I think let's really go after cleaning up this sample and show our scientists what we can do.
Sure.
Let's do solid phase extraction. Mm-hmm. And let's use maybe 4 different sorbents to see how they all compare in performance. But let's see specifically how they do with cleaning up what we just looked at, phospholipids.
All right, let's do it.
Okay.
So here's the chromatogram from those 22 synthetic cannabinoids. The method is really complex. We don't want to be tinkering around with it too much. You see, we got everything mostly separated. Those 2 isobaric compounds, peaks 9 and 10, we're able to resolve those chromatographically. So we don't want to mess around with that at all.
Yeah, sure. A lot of times people will try to resolve matrix interferences away from their compounds of interest. But when you've got a complex chromatogram like this, it's better just to take a step to remove them.
Okay.
So since we talked a lot about phospholipids and matrix effects specifically, let's take a look at those 4 different SPE sorbents that we used and also the impact of our cleanup in terms of matrix effects, which is the most important thing for quantification. So we can see here that for most of the compounds, everything looks pretty good, but we definitely have a problem with compound JWH203. We can see that there's a lot of ion suppression going on.
Yeah, what's going on with that?
Yeah, what exactly is happening?
What did you do?
So if we take a closer look, we can see that phospholipid 524 is actually co-eluting exactly with our compound of interest, JWH203. So this is definitely going to cause a problem with our matrix effects. So if we take a closer look at the impact of the phospholipids, we can see that there's a direct correlation between the presence of the phospholipid in our final sample and the matrix effects. So if we take a look at the left-hand column, we see the sample cleanup. And you can see the presence of the phospholipid that where we see on the left-hand side directly correlates to the amount of matrix effects that we see on the right-hand side. So you can see with the 3 bottom examples, we have a lot of matrix effects. With the top example, where the phospholipid has effectively been removed, we see very little matrix effects.
Oh, Kim, way to put in a little extra overtime there today.
I know.
Just trying to help out the customers.
But it was worth it. It was.
So let's get back to the original myth. You know, is protein precipitation good enough?
I think we have to say that one was busted, like we did earlier. But there are things you can do to take care of the problem.
Exactly right. Mm-hmm. Using some sort of SPE.
Yep, that works.
Yep, to get rid of those pesky little phospholipids.
I know, they're sticky.
Yep. So I'll get right back to the customer. I'll let them know, you know?
Okay.
Yep.
Yep, let them know there are options. If you'd like your question to be answered on a future episode, please feel free to email us at trustyourscience@waters.com.